Another question was, I was talking with Sidi Tariq about what we mentioned yesterday about the Aqidah. And we said Aqidah was a shart for the Tariq. And boring as it may be, and uninteresting and unstimulating as it may be, you have to have the same Aqidah as the majority of Muslim for the majority of Islamic history. Okay, you have to have the Aqidah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, okay, in regard to all the points. Okay. So the points that are agreed upon, you have to agree with them. In other words, everyone has to be an Ashari or Maturidi. Okay, and now since it's a condition for the Tariq, we'd say it bears a little bit you should exposit it a little bit so you can understand what it's about. Okay, what does it mean to be an Ashari? What does it mean? Ashari, it's like a madhab. There's four madhabs in fiqh. There's two madhabs in aqidah. Okay, so the Ashari's have had a rash of bad publicity, mainly because Ibn Taymiyyah has been reified in the past two centuries. As from being a forgotten minor figure in the Hanbali madhab, he's been made the Sheikh of Islam because of the oil billions. And because the people in the 19th century, the reformers of Islam, needed some way to free themselves from the traditional Sharia in order that they could throw their arms around the neck of the West. And one of the most useful tools of this was the Masalih al-Mursala of Ibn Taymiyyah in his fiqh, of the open-endedness of the Sharia. And also another aspect, a rather unsavory aspect of Ibn Taymiyyah's fiqh, which was that he called into the position of the Islamic mujtahideen was that my position is, as I mentioned, my position is correct, and it is possible that it could be a mistake. And the position of my opponent is incorrect, and it's possible that it could be a position. Ibn Taymiyyah, in the Raf al-Manam, termed the ijtihad, and so there's in the hadith, in the Sahih hadith, we find that the mujtahid, who is the hakim, who judges, and his ijtihad is mistaken, who knows and everything about the question, and he uses his effort to reach the correct ijtihad, but he's mistaken, he has a reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the hakim, the mujtahid, who is mistaken, who strives his utmost to reach the correct position about what the Prophet did, or what the Prophet would have said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, had he been alive to see this new thing that we're issuing a judgment about, who is correct on the issue, has two rewards. A reward for striving and a reward for being correct. Okay, as opposed to the unqualified. When someone unqualified gives an opinion about something, he's in the hellfire. That's what we've clarified elsewhere. Okay. So Ibn Taymiyyah was the first one, 700 years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to say that no, the people who are mistaken in their ijtihad, this is actually bid'ah. Okay. And is unacceptable. It means what? It means that everything that is in that the Islamic tolerance is gone, and that everything that the Shaykh of one's neighborhood says is right, and is sunnah, and is haqq, and is the manhaj. And everything that the Shaykh of one's neighborhood doesn't agree with is bid'ah. And so what? And so we get to fight among the Muslims. Oh boy. And so, for all of these, so we have, but before, all of the madhabs of the Muslims are acceptable, were acceptable before the reform Islam. Okay, so we have four of these madhabs in works of the body and the Sharia. And in Aqidah, the works of the mind, okay, as opposed to Tasawwuf, which is works of the heart and Ruh, basically. In Aqidah, we have two madhabs. Okay, everybody knows the madhabs of fiqh. What are they? Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi, and Hanbali. Okay, and in the madhabs of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah in Aqidah, we have the Ash'ari and Maturidi madhabs. Okay, the book of Firaq, and Tazkira fil Firaq, it's the book that Azhar teaches about Islamic sects. It has every single sect in Islam listed and the basic beliefs of each one. And it has even the Sunnah wal Jama'ah listed as a sect. And it says, how does it define them? It says, those who believe in either the Ash'ari or Maturidi Aqidah. So it behooves us to know what we're talking about, what these madhabs represent. And so we'll talk about them shortly today, just give a little thumbnail sketch of Aqidah. Ibn Taymiyyah, to his discredit, believed that the Ash'aris, who include all of the Malikis and virtually all of the Shafis and a great number of the Hanafis and even many of the Hanbalis, Ibn Taymiyyah believed that the Ash'aris were kafirs who were outside of Islam. This fact about Ibn Taymiyyah is not known. It's not known by the most of the people who say Shaykh al-Islam and this and that, but this is what he believed. It's in his Minhaj al-Sunnah. And the basic problem that he had with them was that they were not anthropomorphists, and he was. Ibn Taymiyyah believed that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was bounded by six directions, was encompassed by space. Okay, what's the proof for this? The proof is a book that's coming out in Jordan now. It's called Al-Kashif al-Saghir, the smaller disclosure or revelation. And it's a book of 500 pages about Ibn Taymiyyah's Aqidah by an extremely able person, Saeed Foda, who's an Ash'ari scholar who's appeared in Jordan now, and he's teaching the Shabab. And he's established this. He's debated the Ibn Taymiyyads publicly in Jordan, and he's established this. Ibn Taymiyyah thought that Allah was limited, finite, and that furthermore he was bounded by six directions, neither of which are acceptable in the Ash'ari, because Allah laysa kamithlihi shay'. Okay, so we've mentioned the Ash'ari school. What is it that Ash'aris believe? Who are they? We're told who they are. They're the Malikis and Shafi'is, and in other words, they're the majority of Sunni Muslims for the majority of Islamic history. Okay, now what are they? They were told who they are, now we'll tell what they are. An Ash'ari is someone who believes the following points of Aqidah. Okay, everybody stop me as soon as I come to any point of Aqidah that you disagree with. Okay, so we can get it straightened out right here and now. Okay, the first point of Aqidah is what they believe is in the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, 41 attributes. Allah has more attributes than these and more divine names than these, but they focus on 41 attributes. We're talking about the spiritual path, about the tariqah, and something that we mentioned yesterday, namely that while the spiritual tariqah has its own integrals, it has its own elements, and these are the tawbah, which we'll talk about later, or repentance, and zuhud, or abstinence, and tahqiq al-ubudiyyah, the realization of slavehood, of one's slavehood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although these are the integrals. The tariq also has conditions, okay, that are not integrals. Integrals are something that enter into the reality of something and are necessary for it. Conditions are also necessary for it, but they don't enter into the actual entity of it. Okay, so of the conditions of the spiritual path is that one have the correct aqidah, okay? And just as we said that, you know, I don't water down the spiritual path. I don't water it down to make it sanitized for American consumption or Canadian consumption or English consumption or Libyan or Moroccan or Egyptian consumption. Rather, I deliver the tariq exactly as I have taken it. I'm a very conservative person, and I see that the medicines work, and so why not use them full strength? Why water them down until they don't any longer work? So people that take the tariq, and if someone is interested in taking the tariqah, they should get the little booklet, Tariqah Notes, and see if there's anything that they disagree with in there. But among the things is that that we have the aqidah of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. We have a madhab, first of all. A Sufi without a madhab is not a Sufi, unless he's a mujtahid. Okay, there are Sufis that were mujtahid, mujtahids of fiqh. I'm talking about. Such as Sheikh Muhyiddin, for example. Although his madhhab is not followed, it's proper to him alone. But we have to have a madhhab. In other words, you have to be a Hanafi, be a Shafi, be a Maliki, or be a Hanbali, be one of them, because all of the awliya, East and West, are one of the madhhabs of Sunni Islam. Secondly, we have to have an aqidah madhhab, and that's what we're talking about at this instant, as ladies have now entered. We're talking about the two, just as there are four madhabs of fiqh, there are two madhabs of Ahl Sunnah Islam. And we're talking about the madhab of our Shaykh, the Ash'ari madhab. And we mentioned that because the Wahhabi Islam, of which, American Islam is basically Wahhabi, the sheikh of their Islam is Ibn Taymiyyah, and so Ash'ari is a boogie word. You know, it's a method of boogeymen now in America, because Ibn Taymiyyah said that the Ash'aris were all kafirs. Okay, why? Because Ibn Taymiyyah believed in worshipped a finite god who was bounded on all sides by space. And you see this from his Minhaj Sunnah and his other works also. And so he believed in anthropomorphic, a god with some of the attributes of human beings, in other words. And don't get me wrong, I don't say that Ibn Taymiyyah was a kafir, although many imams of Aqidah have said that anthropomorphists are kafirs because they don't worship the transcendent god. I don't say that the anthropomorphist is a kafir, but I say he's a stupid Muslim, or a Muslim who did not have tawfiq in that issue. Okay, so we're defending the Ash'ari Madhab and saying why we believe in it. I'm presenting the Ash'ari Aqidah, the things that we have to believe as Sufis and as Muslims and as Ahl Sunnah. And I'm asking everybody who's here, and ladies, you can ask questions at any time also on any of these things. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about the body, which is the body in the tariqah is 100% in a state of surrender to the Imams of Sharia. What the Imams of Sharia have written down is what we do. Okay? And if the matter is otherwise, you're going to have to wait until you get on do the things that are specified by the Sharia. Okay? And after that, you can progress. Otherwise, your progress will be slower. You know, you get to the same place as everyone else, but only after you start following the Sharia. Okay? This is with the body. With the mind, we believe in certain things. That's what we do with our mind. That's what Allah has commanded us to do with our minds. And here we have some problems in American Islam. Everyone has ideas, and if anyone who's university educated, the natural legacy of a university education is arrogance, after all. You know, an education is you get so you can deconstruct your professor. You know, that's what is important for your master's thesis or for your doctor's thesis. You show how his book is all wrong and your newer ideas are all correct. And so it's a deconstruction of the previous group of teachers. Okay. And that sort of thing, you know, that may be all entertaining in its own way, but it's not suitable for a deen. It's not suitable in the deen. Rather, we take the deen from the people who have taken the deen, back to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Period. Okay? And so we don't have a lot of personal private opinions. Well, that the Sheikh said this, but I think such and such. No, not in Aqidah. Okay? And this is what I found is the difficulty for many people in the West. You know, they're willing to kneel over backwards if you tell them that that's what you have to do to make spiritual progress. You know, I've witnessed some of the other tariqas. But they're not willing to surrender their ideas, their opinions, which they're very proud of and which they don't want to relinquish. And unfortunately, their ship will not sail. Okay, you won't even get out of the blocks until the contrary is the case. Okay, so I wanted to mention the Aqidah, and so I'm saying here and now, listen, you know, if there's anything you disagree with, stop the music, you know, put your question in now. Okay, don't, somebody who's, you know, when the physician is there and they're not willing to tell their symptoms, how is the physician supposed to treat the symptoms? Guess what's in my mind now? No, not likely that he's gonna do so. Okay, so stop me if there's anything you disagree with. This is the first, or the 41 attributes that we believe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, the first of them is that Allah has wujud, okay, existence, being. Okay. Allah has being. Okay, anybody disagree? I don't think anybody here will disagree, hope not. Okay, so no, not even Tamiya, nobody else, I don't think we'll give the Ash'aris a disagreement about that. Okay, so that's the personal attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But his existence, his being, is necessary being. He necessarily exists. Meaning what? By the fact of what he is, he is. The fact of what he is entails that he is. Okay, this is what necessary being. So it is al-wujud, al-wajib. Necessary being. That which necessarily exists by the fact of what it is. And it pertains to Allah
alone.
There are also some things that are necessarily impossible. That is, that which necessarily exists is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That which is necessary and impossible that cannot exist is such things as the existence of a co-sharer in any attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's, the sharik. So the sharik, the existence of a sharik, of an avatar, of a messiah, or, you know, of the Christ in the Christian sense, impossible. It is necessarily non-existent. This is the Shaykh al-Akbar. He says, Al-Ma'lumat Thalatha, the Shaykh Muhyiddin ibn Arabi, he teaches his ontology, conception of, or not conception, but the reality of the case, as a matter, is that things that can be known are three, and of only three types. The first is the necessarily existent, and which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. And the opposite of it, on the other hand, is the necessarily impossible, that which is necessarily non-existent. It is the existence of a co-sharer with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahu laysa kamithlihi shay'. Okay. So Allah, this is the basis for the wahdatul wujud, for the oneness of being of the Sufi metaphysic. Okay. That there is no other. Allah la sharika la. Allah has no sharik in his being, and not in any of his attributes. Existence is one of his attributes, therefore there is no other that exists but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has no co-sharer in it. We'll talk a bit more about this, and so I don't panic if it's not intuitively obvious. Okay. And between these two is al-barzakh al-akbar, between the necessarily existent and the necessarily non-existent, between them is the supreme isthmus. This is the terminology of the Shaykh al-Akbar himself. The supreme interstice, or interworld, between these two opposites. And what is it? It's alam al-imkan. It's the world of possible, i.e. contingent being. And this is who? Us. It's the alam al-mulk. Okay, we don't have real existence. Rather, our existence is temporal. It's we wink into existence and wink out of existence. Okay, we wink into existence in the world of Alastu bi Rabbikum. Am I not your Lord? And then all of the spirits replied, Bala. They said, yes, in the world between, before resurrection. This is where the Prophet is now. People say, well, how can the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam hear us when we say in our salat, Assalamu alaikum ayyuhan nabi wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The Prophet's in Medina, and here I am sitting right here in my salat. How can the Prophet possibly hear us? And the answer is that the people of the Barzakh, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, are not bound by physical dimensions. Okay, distance means nothing to the in the Barzakh. This is one attribute of the people of the Barzakh. Okay, we wink out of the Barzakh, and we reappear in the Hashr, when all the people are gathered on the last day. Fariqun fil Jannah wa fariqun fil Sa'ir. One party in paradise and the other party in the hellfire. Na'udhu billah. And then we disappear from that mawqif, from that vast plane of human beings that we'll find ourselves. We disappear there and we reappear in heaven or hell, after crossing the Sirat. Okay, we're entering Jahannam. Na'udhu billah. And in paradise or in hell. Okay, so that's the final. In the Katib al-Abiyad, which is in the Firdaus, these are the stations for the Arifin and for the Awliya and for the ordinary believers in paradise. Okay. The least of the states of the people of Jannah, or of the people of paradise, will be seven times the amount of this world. That's quite an expansive thing. The point being that all of these are contingent. We wink in and we wink out. Okay, and as I mentioned to some of the brothers, you know, it's obvious that the essence of what we are, the madda of this world, is non-being. Okay, where is the you? As we mentioned about the reality of you, where is the you that was here yesterday? Okay, it's gone now. Where is the reality of you as you were as a baby? You know, you look at your little baby photos and you say, that was me. And you, by looking at the photo, you constitute yourself as other. You know, your pure exteriority to that matar, you're completely different than that. It's probably not a single cell of you that's left that's from those days. For example, at the purely material level. Okay, so we're winking in and out of existence. And similarly, all of these things. Take a time-lapse photo of this room. What do you find a week from now? Everybody gone. What do you find a month from now in this room? What do you find 2 centuries from now in this room? Maybe rubble. Maybe it's all under the ground. So we're winking in and out of existence. And so this is the Barzakh al-Akbar. is this temporal existence. Okay, so this is the Sufis, because of this, because they see the fana, because they see that everything is colored with annihilation, this is the side that's facing us, side of things. There's a side towards us and a side towards Allah. The side that's facing us is this annihilatory madahir, annihilatory phenomena or phenomenology. Okay. If we look at the side that's facing Allah, we see the side of permanence, the side that's colored with infinitude. Those are two things. So this is why it's a barzakh. There's a side towards non-being, towards necessary non-being, which is the shariq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wujud. And there's nothing like that. And there's a side that's facing towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the barzakh, the interstice, the interworld. And this is what we find ourselves in. Okay, so this is why we say that Allah alone has wujud. By which we mean what? Necessary wujud. That which necessarily is. We are not necessarily by the fact of what we are. It does not entail that we are. You know, 80 years from now, we'll all be dead. Okay, probably a good deal sooner than that. And the human race will go on, but will be the particular individuals that are alive today won't be here. A new set will be here. Okay, and so forth. So things are winking in and out of existence. So this, the Sufis, because they look at the annihilatory, and this is the point of view of the Quran, كُلُّ مَنْ عَلَيْهَ فَانْ, everyone who is upon it, upon the face of the earth, is perishing. You know, perishing fan is an active participle. It refers to the present in its literal acceptation. It only refers to the future and metaphorically. Okay, كُلُّ شَيْءٍ هَادِكْ إِلَّا وَجْهَ. Okay? Everything is perishing except His countenance, Allah's countenance. Okay? And everything that enters into and that is done for the purely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters into His countenance. And through His countenance, i.e. His being. Countenance means what? His being, His entity. Okay? And everything that enters in that is done for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enters into, is preserved by His entity. Allah preserves it. So Jannah lasts forever. One of the Zanadiqa, one of the people of corrupt convictions, a heretic, he was trying to prove his point that Jannah ends. Not only does the hellfire end, as some of the Zanadiqa, some of the heretics believe, but paradise also ends. He says it's impossible that paradise should persist forever. Why? He says because you're establishing a sharik to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a Sufi that was telling me this, and a Sufi in quotes, one of the phonus balonus Sufis that the 20th century has set up for us to listen to. And he says, paradise ends. And he says, why? Because if it lasted forever, it would be a sharik for Allah in His eternity. And this was enough to show me that he didn't have any knowledge whatsoever of tasawwuf. He didn't have any spiritual realization. Because the person of spiritual realization who has tread the path of tasawwuf with a master reaches beyond temporality. Iman al-Mulk al-Yawm, as we mentioned last night, whose is the dominion today, when Allah has slain everyone on the face of the earth and everyone in the universe. Before He brings them back to life, He'll say in the words of the Quran itself, whose is the dominion today? Nothing. Not a sound will be heard, not a bird, not a plant, nothing will be alive to answer. And Allah will answer Himself, and He'll say, "Lillah al-Wahid al-Qahhar," Allah, the One, the All, the Overpowering, the Ever Triumph, the Invincibly Triumphant. That day, whose is the dominion today? That today is here now with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not waiting for anything to happen, as we mentioned. He is not subject. He is not subjected. He is not subjugated. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, nothing. He's subjugated to nothing. He is free. He's the Ghani. Completely, absolutely free. Okay. So He's not subjected to any of His creatures in time and space or of His creatures. Okay, but we're bound by this time and space. Bound by this time and space. Allah. So this is the wujud. This is what we believe. Okay, so then we have the attributes of Allah include the next five are negative attributes. Things that Allah is not. Okay, they're called negative attributes because they merely describe things that are not true of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first is beginninglessness. Allah had no beginning. So this person didn't understand, and the first one is beginninglessness, the second one is endlessness. Okay? And the person who I was, this is zindiq, this heretic, which is not a complimentary term in Islam at all, who was talking to me, this pseudo-Sufi, who is the victim of a pseudo-Sheikh, that said that Jannah was going to end, that paradise was going to end, he conceived of beginning of endlessness as a temporal juxtaposition of points. In other words, temporal points outside of points. Moment A, moment B, moment C, moment D, etc. Okay, it's a temporal succession of events. Okay, this is what, this is human time, for heaven's sakes. Or this is creature time, this is barzakh, the barzakh al-akbar time. Okay, the time of imkan, of contingent reality that we're subject to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his beginninglessness is identical with his endlessness. And it's here now, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the divine presence. Someone who treads the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who treads this path, the spiritual path that we're talking about these few days that we're here, with sidq, and reaches some attainment, and who comes to know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, understands, he becomes immersed in the bahr al-qidam, in the sea of beginninglessness. This qasida that we sang last night of Shaykh al-Alawis, وَخُدْ بَحْرَ الْقِدَامِ فَذَاكَ بَحْرَ اللَّهِ. It's a person has a ecstasy, ecstasy means literally standing out, stacy, to stand out of something. Ex is to be outside of something. So he stands out of what? Of the entire created universe. Okay, and this is the majal of the khalwa that we shall talk about, inshallah, and develop further. But the hasil is that in relation to our aqidah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has beginninglessness and endlessness. These are the first two of the negative attributes. Negative in the sense that they have the word less in them. Beginninglessness and endlessness. So the proof of this unfortunate person that said that paradise will end, because if we were to consider that paradise would last forever, it would be a sharik with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that he didn't know anything about Allah's eternality. Allah's eternality is present now. Okay, and his beginninglessness is identical with his endlessness. These are merely distinctions as they apply to us. Okay, so we can understand them. Okay, so we can exonerate Allah of what does not befitting to him. As for Jannah, it will be temporal succession. Jannah will be temporal succession. Because why? Because our bodies are there. We say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, the beginningless, the eternal speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, doesn't have any letters. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, the bah comes before the seen becomes before the meme becomes before the alif comes before the lam comes before the ra, and so forth. Okay. When you have something that's beginningless, the eternal, it's atemporal, and so there's no order. In beginningless eternality, there's not anything that's older than something else. Okay, this is one of the reasons why the ulama of Ahl Sunnah say that the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Quran, as it really is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is not composed of sounds and letters. His letters have something, and Allah's speech, his attribute of speech, is beginningless, the eternal. Okay, so the Quran that we have, that we read, that is the word of Allah, is signs that indicate, that point to the meaning, to the Quran, the meaning of the Quran. So Allah is beginningless, the eternal, and endless, the eternal. Okay, and so his beginnings, by considering that Jannah, the paradise, and hellfire last forever, and we've spoken about why they last forever, because they are the reward for our intention, the intention of the kafir to remain a kafir forever. And so he is repaid in kind for his intention. And the intention of the mu'min is to remain a mu'min forever. And so he is repaid by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in kind for his intention. And it's coextensive with his intention, really, when you think about it. But Jannah will last forever in this sense, a forever that pertains to us. Okay, moment after moment after moment, to be endless. Okay, endless in this sense. Okay, this is not the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Okay. And the third of the attributes, you see, qidam and waqa, and mukhalafat al-hawadith means Allah is completely complete dissimilarity from anything created, complete dissimilarity of anything from anything that is created. And we say, well, I'm one and Allah is one. What's the difference? Doesn't number apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The answer is no. Number does not apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One is not a number, it's the principle of all numbers. Secondly, Allah is ahad. His oneness is different from our oneness. Okay, you don't say in Arabic ahad, ithnain, thalatha. You say wahid, ithnain, thalatha. Okay? So Allah's oneness is completely different than our oneness. So he's completely different in every respect. Laysa kamithlihi shay'. contrary to Ibn Taymiyyah and some of the, and the Hanbalis that are anthropomorphists, like the anthropomorphic god of Saudi Arabia. We don't believe that Allah is bounded by directions and is limited by space. It's not limited by anything. Nothing limits Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is infinitude. His infinity. He's infinite. Okay, and aspatial at the same time. Not an infinity that we can understand, but the principle of infinity itself. You know. So he's mukhalif al-hawadith. Complete dissimilarity. Okay, the negative part of this attribute is the dis in the word. Okay. Laysa kamithlihi shay'un wa huwa as-sami'ul 'alim. The names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ibn al-Arabi says, are not the names of Allah, but rather the names of the names, in the sense that I've just explained, that the beginningless word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to the meanings that are beginningless and in principle atemporal. And the fourth of the negative attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Allah mukhalif al-hawadith al-ghina al-muhal al-mukhassas. Is his complete freedom of need for any site, any place to be manifest in, or for anything to determine. He's completely free of need for any determinant and any place in which to, or time to be manifest in. And then the fifth of the negative attributes is al-wahdaniyah, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, and this is what the way of the methodologically and experientially and in terms of the fruits of the tariqah, this is the one that is most important for us, the oneness. Okay. Wahdaniyah, meaning that Allah is one in his entity, his person, in other words, if you can say it that way, in his attributes, his divine attributes, and his names, and Ibn al-Arabi would add his rulings. And this is the sounder position. So everything that exists, so that means that Allah has no sharik, there's no co-sharer with Allah in any of these things. Okay, and one of his attributes, as we mentioned, is wujud, his being. Okay, so we don't have any being that competes with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rather, we have a hukum of contingent being. The ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that we should be here in this room today, on this date, at this time, sitting on this floor here, you know, talking, listening to each other. So these are the rulings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then, okay, nobody has heard anything that they disagree with, I don't think, about the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you also have to know that Allah has attributes, the sifat al-ma'ani. Okay, and what are they? They're that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has qudra, omnipotent power. Power. The attributes of Allah include power, include will, include knowledge. We won't go into these in detail, it's not important now. But it's to know that the laysa kamithlihi shay'un, there are nothing whatsoever like these attributes. And these three attributes especially are especially significant for our phenomenology in the tariq. How we understand what's going along. You know, if Allah is one and there's nothing but the one in existence, how can we see the many? And the answer is that we said all of the things in this barzakh, in this interstice or interworld between absolute non-being and absolute being, and between the existence of a sharik, all of the things in this barzakh are determined by his beginninglessly eternal knowledge. We existed in the knowledge of Allah, and your real true reality is as Allah knows you to be. Will you end up in Jannah or will you end up in the fire? Allah knows with his beginningless eternal knowledge. These are called the ayan al-thabita in the metaphysic of the Shaykh al-Akbar. They were translated by some people, by one, Titus Burkhardt, as the immutable essences. But they're not essences. It's a mistranslation. Essence is the what something is. The essence of this is that it's a man. The essence of this is that it's a microphone. The essence of this is that it's a house. Okay, essence is what answers the question, what is it? Okay, so it's not the immutable essences. He wants to make them like the Platonic ideas, which they're not. Rather, the ayan thabita in Ibn Arabi, ayan meaning the particular person, the particular individuated reality that you are, okay, was known to Allah in beginningless eternity, okay, by his knowledge. Okay, the divine will connected with this and specified you. specified your the times and places and your height and weight and so forth and your age and the time in which you would be found with these other people that are here today. So it specified this madhar with his divine will. And his kudra brought it into effect. His omnipotent power brought it into being. Okay, with his kudra. So everything that exists in the eyes of the Sufis and in the eyes of reality, in fact, exists between these three attributes. Knowledge, irada, will, divine will, and kudra, divine omnipotence. Okay, it's one thing to say this and to believe it in point of aqidah, in point of the intellect, and it's another to see, and another thing, a different thing is to see it. Seeing it as something else. Okay, seeing is believing. So this meshhed, and further, transcending this meshhed, transcending this site of manifestation, to realize that these attributes, that all things, as Sheikh Lalawi said, that the divine attributes inherit all of the qualities and all of the rulings out from the things, from the phenomenal things around us. Okay, they're subsumed in the divine attributes, and the divine attributes la tufarik al mawsuf, as-sifatu la tufarik al mawsuf. The attribute is not found distinct or separately from that which is it is an attribute of, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So everything returns to Allah. The hukum, the reality of every single individuated thing returns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In al hukmu, inna lillah, in the words of the Quran. The ruling is not except Allah's ruling. And so this is a reason why we have complete iltizam with the sharia in the tariqah. There's no, you know, some people have depicted tasawwuf that it's the Barnum and Bailey circus, and if anybody can sneak under the tent flap and get into the real show, then all the better, you know. The haqiqah, the beholding the divine oneness, the divine reality, is the show, and the sharia is just the tent around it. You know, if we can somehow dodge the ticket taker, and it's not like that with the Sheikh al-Akbar, it's not like that at all. The divine rulings are part of the divine entity. The divine rulings are one and the same, a reflection of one and the same reality. Allah is not composed of parts, you know, the shin bone connected to the thigh bone, etc., etc. All this doesn't apply to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so this is, the sharia is identical with the haqiqah for Ibn al-Arabi and for our sheikhs. So there's no secret departments, you know, well, you know, maybe if I do this, you know. So there's no sneaking in the back door. You know, if you want to have a fath that is luminous, if you want to have a spiritual experience that is luminous and that is all nur, then you have to take the means that Allah has legislated. There's no exceptions. Naam Siddhi.
You said that he is not subjected to two of which are time and space. We, however, are bound by time. Is this in fact debunk the Christian theory of how God became a man?
This is exactly the proof of the Muslims for the absurdity of Allah being Jesus, or being any of the Hindu avatars, or being, you know, this rock that I have in my hand that I consider God, or being anything else, you know, for example, on the part of the mushriks. Okay, so the shirk, the dhulam that the mushrikeen have done, and the reason that they land in hellfire forever, is because they've confined Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to a particular locus, and he is ghaniyun an al-alameen bin-nas. By the text of the Quran himself, by what he has spoken about himself, he informs that he is absolutely free of need of anything that he has created. Whereas something that is only 2 meters tall or less, as the Isa was, alayhi salatu wasalam, is, you know, if you, the human being, as we know, if you've ever said ouch about anything, you know that human beings only live within narrow limits, and if you take a human being beyond these limits, bad things happen to them, and they don't live or last very long. Okay, and Allah is quite other than that. Allah is free of need of anything that He has created. And this freedom of need, this ghina, as we say, he said, Allahu ghani, an al-alameen, literally rich, but meaning actually free of need for anything that he's created, is the reason exactly why he could not be Jesus, or could not be the avatars, or could not be. Okay, well, why can't Allah simply incarnate himself in Jesus, then, if he can do anything? And the answer is that Qudra omnipotent power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not connect with anything that is in principle impossible. Could Allah commit suicide? The answer is that the question is meaningless. Because can, in this question, in the form of the question, the form of the verb that I used, could Allah do this? Okay, this could only connects with things that are, in principle, possible. It's as meaningless as if you ask, could Allah create a square circle? Could Allah create a four-sided triangle? All of these questions are meaningless, and none of them enters into every attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a da'irah. Has a sphere in which all of the things that are under its sphere enter into. Okay, and the da'irah of qudra, the da'irah of ability of the divine omnipotence. Omnipotence is only connected with things that are that are possible. As for things that are impossible, they don't enter into it. Okay, such as what? Such as Allah ending himself. Could Allah decide not to be? The answer is no, because the qudra does not relate to impossibilities. This is the tenet of faith of Ahl Sunnah. Could Allah create himself in the womb of Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam? The answer is no. It's impossible. Why? Because it's impossible that Allah could cease to lose any of his perfections. Allah is perfect. And if he were to lose any of his perfections, he would no longer be God, which is impossible. So qudra, innama qudra tata'alluq bil mumkinat. This is another point. It deserves our consideration in Aqidah, because it's the way things are. For a person who says, can Allah create a square circle, does not know what he means. You say, what do you mean, square circle? If you ask about what he means, he doesn't know what he means, because it's just a jumble of words. It doesn't mean anything, such that the qudra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could connect with it. Similarly, God become man does not mean anything. It has no meaning. It's a contradiction in terms. Okay, it would either be a god or it would be a man. Two essences, how can two essences be one identical, one and the same thing? So there might be someone who believed it, but we don't believe it. I'm a man and I'm a horse. Does that sound right? I mean, some people you can say, well, if you believe that, then you could say you're a man and you're a himar, a donkey. It's possible, but only metaphorically speaking. Okay. So, it's a lot of the qudra in the mutata'alluq bil qudra bil mumkinat. It's an important principle in Aqidah. And so Allah is wahid, and he has wahdaniya in all of these things, in these four things. This is the basis for the madhhab of Ibn Arabi. Ibn Arabi, he says, he believes in wahdat al-wujud, but we've already heard that he says that the ma'lumat, not the mawjudat, not the existing things, but al-ma'lumat talatha, he says, things that can be known are three. The necessarily existent, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. The necessarily impossible, the existence of the sharik, the co-sharer with Allah. And the isthmus between the two. Okay. So he says, so you find that Ibn al-Arabi has a threefold ontology. Being applies only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he does have a threefold ontology with which he understands reality. Okay, but he doesn't call them mawjudat, he calls them ma'lumat, things that can be known. Because the sharik doesn't have any existence, obviously. Sharik doesn't have any existence, a kosher with Allah, it's not real, it's false, it's necessarily non-existent, but it's known. And so it does have some sort of ontological status, namely impossibility. Okay, and so we said that all created things, they exist between these three attributes. Okay. Qudra, irada, and ilm. Okay, also Allah is Sami'a. He hears everything. Okay? And he's basir, and he sees everything. And he has hayat, also life, not dead. And he has, and he has kalam, he's mutakallim. Okay, and so these are 13 attributes, I believe. See, it's first one, six, yeah, these are 13 attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, there are seven more attributes, which are that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he does not only have omnipotent power and will and life and so forth, these last seven that we named, in virtue of his entity, but rather in virtue of his being these. Okay, he has them in virtue of these attributes. They are attributes. Okay, and so this brings the total up to 20 attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are all attributes that are necessarily true of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, did anyone hear anything they disagreed with? I don't think anyone did. I didn't. I think every Muslim believes them. No. It's the ruling of something is it relates to Ibn al-Arabi's the ruling for something is its innate, it's what it is. Okay, so this is a post, or this is a man, or this is a mu'min, or this is a kafir, or so this is a good act, or this is a bad act. These are qualities, whereas actions are the existentiating of these things. So there's a difference there. The reality of what they are is the hukum. The fact that they're of their being is Allah's existentiation of His khalq, His action. Okay, so we have these 20 attributes. And then we come to 20 more attributes that are that which is impossible. Just a second. That which is impossible of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Ashari Aqidah. And what are these? They're the contraries of the first 20 attributes that we just named. The opposites. Okay, life, for example. It's impossible that Allah could be dead. Okay, beginningless. Okay, it's impossible that Allah could have a beginning. Okay, so they're impossible. They're denials of each of the previous things that we mentioned that we said were necessary of Allah. Therefore, their opposites are impossible of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so that brings the total up to 40 attributes. First 20 are necessarily true of Allah. Second 20 are necessarily impossible of Allah. And then there's one more attribute only, and that which is merely possible of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is only one attribute, and that is Allah can create or destroy anything that is possible, any contingent thing. Okay, so this is His right. No. No, see, just a second, yeah.
Why that Allah has...
His Qadir. Well, because He is not only... that His being the Qadir does not only rename His entity, but also there's an attribute there that is deployed in reference to the maqdurat, in reference to the things that the divine omnipotence effects. And there's a difference of opinion among some of the ulama. Ibn al-Arabi, for example, felt that Allah did not have attributes, that he called them nisab. He did not call them attributes, but called them nisab, meaning relations. In other words, Allah does not have the attribute of rahmah, or the quality of mercy, but rather rahmah, the quality of mercy, is understood in a different way. He didn't deny the fact that Allah had mercy, but he said rahmah as an attribute is merely the sum total of all things that are under the sway of Allah's mercy. And there are specific relations to Allah that is what we term this attribute. Do you understand? In other words, the sum total of things that are whether real or potential, whether potential or actual, are what we call this attribute of rahmah. So this is. But anyway, the point, the main point for the reason that the Asharis say this, is that the attributes are not merely synonyms for Allah, but rather they indicate qualities that Allah has, attributes that Allah actually does have. Okay, that's why they have the distinction. Okay, so these 41 attributes are what the Asharis believe about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, and so I'm de-bogifying the Asharis, so to speak. No.
It's kind of a semantic point, but you said wahdaniyya was the oneness was a negative.
Yeah, it's oneness because it's the... Well, why do they say it's the oneness? Because it means la sharika lahu fi dhatihi, wa la sharika lahu fi sifatihi, wa la sharika lahu fi af'alihi. Okay, they say because he has no co-sharer. Okay, the operant word is we call it a negative attribute because the word no there, no
so
co-sharer.
In the next 20, which are the negation of would be the opposite? Like I would see that as being a positive.
Yeah, no, it means that he has a sharik in one of those things. It's impossible that he should have a sharik in any of those things. The existence of a sharik is the opposite of his wahd.
No. Okay.
And so these things, and so I don't think I've talked too long, unfortunately, but. These things, I'm just pointing out that when I'm saying that the tariq, you have to have an aqidah that is correct and it conforms to the aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The point being here is that you already have this aqidah anyway. And so don't panic when you hear the word Ashari or something, because what I've just mentioned is from a classic text of Ashari aqidah. And also there's 9 attributes of the prophets, alayhim as-salatu was-salam, that we also believe. 4 of them are necessary, and 4 of them are impossible, and 1 of them is merely possible. So we'll conclude the discussion of our 50 points of Aqidah. These 50 points are the heart and basis of Ashari Aqidah. And what I mean by saying that you have to have your Aqidah correct when you have a tariqah is that the necessary attributes of the prophets are amana, first of all, meaning trustworthiness. They were trustworthy. They were not treacherous. They kept their trust. Amana. It's trust, literally, in terms of keeping a trust. Okay, and the second is that is fatana, means intelligence. And the third is tabligh, meaning that they delivered their messages in the entirety. They didn't hide anything. They delivered their messages in their entirety. And also khalu min al-amrad al-munafara. They were free of all diseases that cause people to disgusting diseases.
How about Sayyidina Ayyub alayhi salam?
The story that Sayyidina Ayyub alayhi salatu wasalam had worms in his flesh and so forth. This is one of the baseless stories of Bani Israel. This is an Israeli, and it's not permissible to believe of Ayyub under any circumstances. It's wrong.
What did he have?
We'll discuss it in the last point, okay. Inshallah. As for afflictions, they could have afflictions, but not a disgusting disease. You know that would disgust people. Why? Because they're ambassadors from Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. And if you send an ambassador to somebody, you don't send a monkey. You send the very most handsome, the very most authoritative, the best. You know, best. You send someone who to represent your country, who looks like an ambassador. Who can talk and can look and can, you know, and so forth. And so these are ambassadors from the Rabbul Alameen, from Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Okay, the four things that are impossible are the contraries of these. First, the khiyana, the tabligh. Balagha is not only the, but also tabligh. Okay, is treachery the first. Okay, it's impossible that they could have treachery. You say that it's the opposite of a man, and the opposite of tabligh is ketman, is the that they hid anything. Okay, they delivered everything that they were ordered to. It doesn't mean that there was no knowledge that they kept, that every single bit of knowledge was divulged to every single member of the ummah. No, because you have the hadith of Abu Huraira in Sahih Bukhari. حَفِظْتُ مِنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. I have memorized from the Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم وَأَعَيْنِ, two containers, two vast receptacles, big receptacles. أَمَّا الْأَوَّلْ فَبَثَثْتُهُ. As for the first of them, I have divulged it. وَأَمَّا الثَّانِي فَلَوْ بَثَثْتُهُ قُتِعَ هَذَا الْبُلْعُونَ. He says, as for the second of them, if I were to divulge it, this throat of mine would be slit. Okay, indicating, and then the ulama have had different words to say about this utterance that is in Sahih Bukhari from Abi Huraira. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what the tabligh, what the delivering his message means, is that everything that was required for salvation, everything that was required for the Sharia and for the Aqidah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam delivered. Okay, there are also secrets that not everyone in the ummah was responsible to know. Okay, such as what? Such as the name of the munafiqeen, the names of the munafiqeen. There were munafiqeen among the people. And when they returned from Tabuk, they tried to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They waited to ambush him at a mountain pass. And the angel Jibreel told the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he avoided them, and he went back by a different route. And he knew who they were, but he didn't kill them sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, because why? Because for the sake of the name, the good name of Islam, he didn't want it said that Muhammad kills his companions. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. People that create fitna among the Muslims today should take note of that. People trying to kill the Prophet himself and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because of the interest of presenting a united front for Islam didn't want to kill them. Because of that. This is a lesson for our times. Okay, but he didn't, he divulged those to Hudhaifa, for example. And no one else knew, they didn't know the names of them. And so similarly, there were secrets that not everyone in the ummah is responsible to know. Okay? And this is, and as far as the Sufis are concerned, the hadith indicates al-haqiqah, a depth of knowledge. Okay? that was conveyed to us, okay, by our imams of the tariqa. Okay, not that there's anything different in the aqidah or anything different in the sharia, but rather there's knowledge, a depth of knowledge and of understanding that not everybody is responsible to know, and that not everybody's mind can comprehend, more importantly. Okay, so out of mercy for them, that they don't know it. Okay, but everything that is that it was obligatory for him to convey was conveyed. So this is tabligh. Opposite is kitman. It's implied that he was hiding something that was that needed to be said intentionally. Okay. And then balada. It's the opposite of fatana. Stupidity. It's not possible. There was no prophet that was sent to any people that was an imbecile. Hasha. Yeah. Because they had to be intelligent so they could establish a case against the kafirs, the mushriks of their times. Speak. And finally, the existence of amrad munafa. Balaka also. Okay. And so the existence of sicknesses that would cause revulsion. Okay, this is eight attributes that of the prophets that we believe. The ninth thing is something that is merely possible of the prophets, and that is any state of being, whether a sickness or something else, that is not disgusting, that would not disgust people and send people from them. And this is Uyub's sickness was of something of this. Okay, it was of something of this nature. Okay, so any sickness that normally happens, like could the Prophet ﷺ or could any Prophet get a cold? Yes, it's possible. Could he get the flu? Yes, it's possible. Okay, could he be poisoned? It's possible, for example. Could he die? Yes, he died. So all of these things, other physical human states. Did he wed women? Did he make love? Yes, he did. These are states that are not ordinary human states, that are the course of human events. Everyone has these states, such as eating, such as drinking, such as so forth. All of these, and going to the marketplace, all of these human states, these are all possible for the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Anything that is not beneath his dignity as a Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And so these are the 50 points of aqidah. This is what I mean by aqidah. Okay? As for the Sahaba, we talked about this in terms of Aqidah. What about the differences that broke out about them between Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan and between Ali ibn Abi Talib? There was a difference between because of the killers of Uthman, as everybody who studied Islam knows, and Ali's ijtihad was that because of the mixture of the killers were found, that people came from Egypt and killed Uthman. And they were related to some of the people. And because of their dispersal in the Muslim forces, Ali said that it would compromise Islam. It would be too great of a body blow against Islam in the very beginning, in its weakest phase. So his ijtihad was not to seek them, hunt them down, and avenge the blood of Uthman. This was his ijtihad. And it may have been a correct ijtihad, and it may have been an incorrect ijtihad. But no one of any scholarly learning has ever accused Ali of being wrong in this, said that he was wrong in his ijtihad. The position of Muawiyah ibn Abi Sufyan was that Ali's being the Amir al-Mu'mineen, being the Khalifa of that time, his decision raised the Khilaf from the people. Okay, the decision of Hukm al-Hakim, yafa'al al-Khilaf. Okay, the decision of the ruler, the Islamic Khalifa, raises all disagreement and difference of opinion about it. Okay. Muawiyah said no. He says, I am the Wali Adem. I am the one who is, I'm Uthman's kinsman, who has the right to retaliate, and that what right is obligatory for me by the fire of the Quran, and I don't waive it. And so he wanted the people who had killed Uthman hunted down, and he wanted them to be avenged. And so this was a difference of opinion upon ijtihad, and they fought each other over it. Okay, so what about that? And now the fashion has come in, and I'm warning myself and you against it, because the fashion has come that Muawiyah was no good, and Muawiyah was a cred, and when Muawiyah was this and that. And nobody, none of our sheikhs, and none of the sheikhs of the tariqah, has criticized Muawiyah or has villainized Muawiyah. Okay? A war broke out between the Sahaba, but we believe that the people on both sides had their case, had their ijtihad. Okay, so they did it from ijtihad. This is the position of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah. If Ali was alive today, and Ali and Muawiyah were alive today, we would fight with Ali. Why? Because he was the Wali al-Amr. He was the Khalifa of the Muslims. The authority was on his side. Okay, this is my personal interpretation. As for those who, you know, who of the Sahaba do we like best? Or who is the most beloved? It depends. You know, who is the, this is something as to who is the best of the Sahaba. You know, they say that the in Imam al-Ghazali and others of the Ashris and other books, they say the order of Khilafah is also the order of Fadl. The which of them was best? The best of the Sahaba after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Abu Bakr, and after him Uthman, or after him Umar, and after him Uthman, and after him Ali. Okay, and also we acknowledge this. We acknowledge this because it is the opinion of the Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. You know, we acknowledge this. But it doesn't mean that these are the ones that are most beloved to us. You know, personally, who is the most beloved to me of all of the Sahaba? Ali ibn Abi Talib. He's the one I love the best of all of the Sahaba after the Rasul. I've seen Ali in a dream. And Shaykh al-Alawi saw Ali in a dream also. And he radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he said, I am Ali and your tariq is Alawiyah. So all of our spiritual knowledge from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this tariq comes by way of Ali, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, from his son Hassan, and then down to the Shaykhs of the tariqah through Ali. So we like, and the question of who is best, you know, I submit, I defer, you know, it's not a question of, you know, Abu Bakr, you know, and Omar and Uthman and Ali. Some of the Sahaba themselves disagreed upon who was the best, you know, among them. But no one disagreed of any, they didn't disagree about the validity of their Khilafah. And Salama, for example, was asked, you know, who is the best Sahabi? And what did she say? She said, why, Abu Salama, of course. Her husband before he died, and she married the Rasul Salama. Okay. So it's not a question upon those absolute unanimity, and whoever disagrees is a kafir. But we say, you know, what Imam al-Ghazali said, that the order of the Fadl is the same as the order of Khilafah. As for who we love the best, that's on our heart. We're not responsible for that. Yeah. Who is the most knowledgeable in the inner path? In my view, Ali, without any question. Okay, so the best doesn't mean that the others were more knowledgeable than him. And also, so we love Ali, and we have a literal connection. We have a lineal connection with Ali, and our knowledge is through Ali. Okay, and so we are the Shia of Ali, not the Shia. Okay, and so this we have a better right to Ali than the Shia do. The last words of Ali in this dunya were, La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so this is a consideration. So this is how we understand the difference between the Sahaba. This is our attitude towards Ali. We have a better right to Ali than the Shiite, and we have more love for Ali than the Shiites do. Okay. And we're the faction of Ali, in other words, the faction of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Usikum bi ashabi. And so we'll end with this note, inshallah, or take a break now, inshallah. Usikum bi ashabi. Thumma ladina yalunahum, thumma ladina yalunahum. Thumma yafshu al kadib. Hatta yahnaq al rajul wa la yustahaf. Wa yashhad al shahidu wa la yustashhad. Ala. لا يخلو أن رجل بأمرأة إلا وكان ثالثهما الشيطان. Okay, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, I enjoin you to adhere to my generation, to my ashab, okay, the Sahaba. So this command, what do we understand from it? We understand that we have extreme veneration for all of the Sahaba. As I mentioned, the madhab of our sheikhs is that Abu Sufyan, you know, with one of the Sahaba, father of Muawiyah, has a higher stature with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than 1,000 Abdul Qadir al-Jailanis. Why? Just because they're Sahaba. Just because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose them to be the Ashab of the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Sahaba deserve respect. ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ ثُمَّ الَّذِينَ يَلُونَهُمْ. Who? The early Muslims. Then those that came after him, then those that came after him. And then lying will become widespread. Okay, and the Prophet talks about the ahwal of the liars. Then those people will swear, and they won't be worth swearing, because they won't be worth taking to asking the maids to be sworn to do, or to say to aver or something. And people will bear testimony, and they won't be worth bearing testimony. And he says, "Ala la yakhlu anna رجل بامرأة إلا وكان ثالثهما الشيطان. There's no man will be alone with a woman except that the third of them, third party, is the shaitan, is there. Prophet swearing that that's true in this hadith. This hadith is sahih, it's related by Tirmidhi. And then the next word is the reason I'm relating this hadith, which is the Prophet says, عليكم بالجماعة وإياكم الفرقة. He says, adhere to the majority, and beware of being a splinter group, being a party apart from the majority. فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ مَعَ الْوَاحِدَةِ وَمَعَ الْوَاحِدِ. For verily the shaitan is with one. وَهُوَ مِنْ إِثْنَيْنِ أَبْعَدُ. And he is farther away from two. مَنْ أَرَادَ بُحْبُوحَةِ الْجَنَّةِ فَلْيَلْزِمِ الْجَمَاعَةَ. He says, whoever wants the wide expansiveness of paradise, let him stay to the jama'ah. Let him stay to what the vast majority of Muslims have believed from time immemorial. He said, when he finished the hadith, he said, مَنْ سَرَّتْهُ حَسَنَتُهُ وَسَاءَتْهُ سَيَّأَتُهُ فَذَلِكُ مُؤْمِنٍ. He said, whoever's good deeds please, and whose bad deeds sadden, that is the mu'min. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. This is a sahih hadith, and it is worth understanding. So, our aqidah, in terms of aqidah, we check out to see what the vast majority of Muslims have believed, okay, from time immemorial. Okay, where do you want to look for this? Look in the first volume of Ihya Ulumuddin, Imam al-Ghazali. He's one of the great, great imams of Ahl al-Sunnah al-Jama'ah. Okay? And he'll spell it out in detail for you. And I've tried to translate it in the Reliance of the Traveler. And what is it? Book U and B, I think. Something like that. So that's a basic thumbnail sketch if anyone wants to review any of these points. And also, Sidi Murtada has worked out a complete book of Aqidah for the people of Tariqah. And inshallah, we'll be reviewing it. And we'll be printing it in both languages. And it will give this is just a thumbnail sketch, even though I've dwelt on it sometimes, hoping that Sidi Hamid's recordings can make this knowledge available to demystify the Aqidah. It's nothing very complicated. Okay, so people that have private opinions and private things, well, the Sheikh said this, but I believe such and such with my great intellect and superior understanding and insight, forget it. You know, you won't progress in the tariq until you get your Aqidah straight. وَعَلَيْكَ بِالْجَمَاعَةِ وَإِيَّاكُمْ الْفُقَّةِ. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. We'll take a break of 5 minutes. Some of you had questions, inshallah. We'll come back with our questions in Tasawwuf specifically. So this is the last we'll talk about Aqidah, inshallah, unless we have time to go over Murtada's work, inshallah. We'll go over some of it on Monday, possibly after the main session. But Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Everything else we'll be talking about Tasawwuf, inshallah.